Hello and welcome again to TTNT, coming to you from the sanctuary of the Beargrass Missionary Baptist Church for our regular Thursday night TTNT. We don't own the rights to the music that you're hearing in the background, but again, as always, we're glad that God has blessed some people to use their gifts, that they can be a blessing unto us. Thank you for joining us tonight, and we're going to wait a few moments, hoping that some others will get on. So tag your friends. Let them know that Beargrass TTNT, it is live from the sanctuary, and we're on right now. Again, we do not own the rights to the music. That's more than I can bear by God's property. We do not own the rights to the music that you're hearing in the background. Those of you that's coming on, we're glad that you are with us tonight. Welcome, welcome. This is Pastor Matthew Smyzer, Jr., Senior Pastor of the Beargrass Missionary Baptist Church, coming to you on a Thursday night with TTNT, our disciple-making Bible study. We do not own the rights to the music that you're hearing in the background. Again, more than I can bear by God's property, He will not put more on you than you can bear. Good evening, and good evening. Good evening to each and every one of you. Thank you for joining us tonight. We're going to wait just a few more minutes and we'll get into the lesson, but we're delighted that those of you that have joined us already, that you are with us tonight on Truthful Transformation Thursday. It is our goal to help each and every one of us be more of a disciple, be more of what Jesus is looking for and expecting us to be, not just pew members, not just showing up at the church and not living the life in front of the world that God would have us to live, but that we come to learn how Christ would want us to live, how Christ wants us to walk, how Christ wants us to treat our brothers and sisters, and even how Christ wants us to treat our enemy. How does Jesus want us to represent Him? And a disciple is a learner. A disciple is a lifelong learner. We're constantly evolving. We're constantly growing. We're constantly asking God to reveal to us through His word and through life experiences and through others that He sent our way, reveal to us what he would have us to know, how he would have us to represent him, that he can be proud and that we can wear well the childhood of our Almighty God. All right, let me just for a moment help us to see that we're living in some tough times, and I want us to pray for the Hickman and Watkins family who funeralized their son, Arian Hickman, today, 22 years old. We're leaving here too soon, and we're leaving here too young. And I'm disturbed by the rate in which our young adults are leaving us. There has to be something that we can do. There has to be a way that we can come together, share with one another, and live the lives that God is calling us to live. So let's keep them lifted in prayer. Also, please keep Reverend Keith Williams. He had a fall and he's at home recuperating, but keep him in your prayers, along with Reverend David Dow, Jesse Lang, and so many others that are at home or that's in the hospital that's dealing with illnesses and sickness. And we want them to know that we are praying mightily for them. Thanks to those who have grouped together, are gathered in groups on Thursday nights to be a part of this Truthful Transformation Thursday study. Thank you so very, very much that your group, I understand we have a group and they get together with some eats and sit in front of their devices and participate in our Bible study lesson. All right, let's have a word of prayer and then we're gonna jump into the lesson. God, how we love you, we adore you. We magnify your most holy and righteous name. Thankful again tonight that you have permitted us to have another opportunity to come and to share one with another, to learn of you. So God, we pray right now that you illuminate your word in our hearts and in our minds. Help us, God, to see better so that we can be better. So we appreciate, God, all that you're doing in our lives, and we're hopeful and prayerful that when we leave this study tonight, we will be just a step closer to you, that we will have just a little deeper understanding of what a disciple really is, and that you would be pleased with our efforts. Bless everyone that's with us tonight, and we pray, God, that you would give them everything that they stand in the need of. I ask these blessings in the name of Jesus, amen. All right, we're continuing on in Christ's teaching. For those of you that may not have been with us, we are in chapter 5 of the Gospel of Matthew, dealing with the Beatitudes, or what has come to be known as the Beatitudes. That's Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5. If you would turn to that, you would note that in the beginning of the chapter where Christ really begins to talk to his disciples, he saw the crowd. And I think I stated that what Christ was doing, he was preparing his disciples to get ready for the first century church. You know, the Old Testament had the law, the Old Testament had the synagogue, and here comes God to fulfill all of what was planned by God so that you and I could have the right to eternal life, so that you and I could be reconciled back to the Father who created us in a way that God intended for the relationship between the Creator and the creation to be. Now, the Bible says that when Jesus saw the crowd, that he went up a little higher into the mountain. And this crowd were people who were hurting. This crowd were people who were suffering. This crowd were people who really needed God in their lives and was going through a terrible time. And I think that many of us can relate to the fact that we have times in our lives where we're just really going through. It may not be all the time, but wow, there are some times when we are just really hurting on all kinds of levels. We are really dealing with issues and problems that seem to have overwhelmed us and has taken over our lives. And a lot of times we don't know how to get out of that. We don't know what it is to do that we need to do in order for us to turn that situation around. And then Christ comes along and says, I am the answer to that. I am the answer to turning your life around, because you need to know that the devil has his hand on you and he delights in sending you through troubles and pains and struggles. The devil delights in making your life miserable. And that's what he gets off on. That that's his trip, is to come and jack you up and make things hard for you. But then Christ is saying, I have more power than the devil. I've defeated him. Christ even defeated him in the chapter before, in chapter 4, when he went into the wilderness. So he gave an example that if we follow the word of God, then we will defeat the attacks of the devil. That does not mean that the devil is not going to attack. It simply means that we have now weapons in the word of God. We have a sword, which is the word. We have the shield, which is our faith. And Paul tells us that we have a suit on. We have the breastplate of righteousness. We have the belt girded around our waist. Our feet are shod in the preparation of the gospel. We have now a way to beat the devil back and get him up off of us. And the way we do that through Jesus, our Christ. And so knowing that Jesus came to demonstrate how we're supposed to live, but most importantly, he came to be the sacrificial lamb. And then once that was complete, Christ was going to go back at where he is now, sitting on the right hand of his Father. He's making intercessions for you and for me. And he knew that these disciples needed to have this type of training. They needed to know what they need to do in order for the first century church to be launched, and the church is still in existence today. And so on last week, we talked from verses 17 down through verse 20, where Christ made it very plain that he did not come to destroy the law or the prophets, but he came to fulfill the law. In essence, in other words, the fulfillment of the law could have never come without Christ, because Christ came to be what I think I would call the right interpretation of the law, to be the essence of what the law is all about. Much of the Old Testament points towards Christ's coming, because that's the only way that we would get back to the Father. From the fall of the first Adam to the sacrifice, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, the second Adam, is what enables us to have a right to the tree of life. So he came to fulfill it. He came to complete the law. Maybe that's the word that I was looking for. Christ came to complete the law. It wasn't complete until Christ came to do what he came to do in order for the law to be fulfilled. Not that he said, I come to change it, but I come to give you a deeper, a better interpretation of it. I come to give you an interpretation to help you to see how you ought to walk as a disciple, how you ought to think as a disciple. And so he even goes as far as to say that that heaven and earth will pass away before one jot or tittle of this law would be changed. And so the fulfillment was not to get rid of it, but to make it what it was intended to be from the beginning. And so he says, whosoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. So let me give you a different view, a different look. Let me give you a more complete understanding of what this law is really all about. Now, keep in mind that all of the sacrifices made in the Old Testament, they covered the sin. But when Christ came as the sacrificial lamb, he took away the sin. It's not that our sins are covered, but it is that those of us that have accepted Christ as our Savior, our state of sin has been taken away, and heaven is our home. And so he says in verse number 20, for I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. He's simply pointing out that the scribes and Pharisees had an outward mentality. It was all about what they did. It was all about the way they dressed and the way they looked. And what Christ is telling us is that our righteousness is from the inside. It is from our hearts. And you can't just be doing a thing and not being a thing. And so in other words, I think I said on last week, it is not my job as pastor, as teacher, to make you do better. It's mine to make you be better. And you be better, as Paul has put it, by the renewing of your mind. Each and every day, we ought to get a new revelation from God. We ought to be seeking a new revelation from God that's going to make us be better. Because folk can do whatever they put their mind to doing. But when you are being better, that means that you have a truth within you from the inside out that makes you who you are, and that's not going to change. That is not for show. It is who you are. So tonight, as we look at verse 20, Jesus gives us an enhanced version of what he is trying to say when he says, I come to fulfill the law. It's about six things that he uses out of the Ten Commandments that helps us to see that it's from the inside. It is what's in your heart that makes a difference, and that things really start from your heart, and then they move out. They move from the inside out, not the outside in. So verses 21, 22, 23, I think down to verse number 26. Let me read that for us real quick. Again, this is the New King James Version. If you have a different version of the Bible, the words might be slightly different, but the meaning and the message, it is the same. It says in chapter 5, verse number 21, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Reka, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First, be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Agree with your adversary quickly while you are on the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge. The judge hands you over to the officers and you be thrown into prison. Assuredly, I say to you, you will by no means get out of there till you have paid the last penny. So he's saying that it's a little deeper than what is being shown on the outside. And I think that there's an issue and a problem that we have in our society and in our world today is how we as children of God look from the outward and what is going on with us on the inside. I'm trying to think of a ready example. So there are folks who say, you know, well, the church folk ain't no better, ain't no different than the folk in the street. I'm seeing the same thing that the people in the street are doing. I'm seeing the church folk doing the same thing. And unfortunately, a lot of times they are right. Because when you have a change, when you have a transformation, it's on the inside. And when the inside, when your heart changes, then your habits and your actions change. If your heart don't change, then your habits and your actions are going to remain just as they were before you had that heart transformation. So in other words, I think I'm trying to say to us is I think we have too many of us who have received Christ as our Savior, but not understand that our hearts really has to change. And that's what changes our attitude. And that's what is really bubbling up inside of us. And that's what comes out. He says in 21, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. Whosoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whosoever is angry. Where does the anger start? The anger starts in our hearts. And so it just doesn't jump out on us. But many times it festers on the inside, and then all of a sudden we explode. It's kind of like a volcano. If you know anything about volcanoes, you would understand that a volcano bubbles up on the inside of the volcano long before it ever explodes on the outside. And what happens is that if we can't control what's happening on the inside, when we explode and that lava flows over, it kills everything it touches. It damages everything that it touches. And that's just kind of how we are with our relationships. When we allow things to build up in our hearts and we don't have any control of that, and we don't have any Jesus with that, then when that explodes, when we explode, then we do damage. And sometimes that damage is not repairable. And so you and I, as children of God, as disciples, we got to guard our hearts. We got to realize that if my heart is right, then my actions is going to be right. So Jesus said, it's not enough to just say, if you murder somebody, that you're going to be in front of the judgment, that you're going to have an issue. He's saying, if you murder them in your heart, then you already got an issue. And that issue is a greater issue than the issue of the physical act, because you've already killed them in your heart. He says, whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Why are you angry with your brother? What has caused you to be so angry with them that it doesn't make any sense, that anger causes you to treat them in such a way that it really don't make sense? And what I've discovered in many times that if I'm angry with someone, and I'm just going at it, my blood pressure goes up, I can't hardly sleep, I'm having all these issues, folk are biting fingernails, hair falling out because they're angry with someone, only to discover that the person that they're angry with has gone on with their life. They've gone on about their business. Now here you are sitting back with blood pressure issues and anxiety issues and not functioning at your maximum capacity because you're so inundated with an anger that you have for somebody else, and they've gone on about their business, and you're the only one that's suffering in that case. You know, I think when we read God's word, when we really make an effort to learn God's word, then we learn some stuff that will help us, such as that God will fight my battle. I don't have to be angry with that person that may have done me wrong or that mistreated me. All I got to do is move on. Let God use me, use the gifts that he's given me, and let God deal with them. Now, our problem, I think, is that we want God to deal with them right now. We want God to get them right now, and we want to be there when he does. And when that happens, then we get some sort of joy or sensation out of the fact of seeing them suffer and hurt. And that's really not the case. You look at what you have missed while you're waiting on something to happen to them. So move on. Let God handle them. If they are wrong, then let God be the one to take care of them. As difficult as it is for us to do, that is the best thing for us to do. So if you're angry with your brother without a cause, you should be in danger of the judgment without a cause. And then sometimes we get angry over stuff that just doesn't make any sense. If you don't like the way a person wears their hair or the clothes that they wear, or whatever, what does that really have to do with you fulfilling your assignment that God has in store for you? You know, what does that really have to do with you achieving what God intends for you to achieve? And so I think that as we go forward, we need to check ourselves when it comes to who we're angry with and why we are angry with them. And every time we see them, it just upsets us. It gets on our last nerve. I mean, it just really pushes us into a whole nother level. Just to think about them, that pushes us to a whole nother level. But look at who's suffering behind it. Jesus is saying, you're better than that. You don't have to worry about them. Let me handle them. What you be concerned with is what I have told you to do, the journey that I have you on, the blessings that I'm going to bestow upon you, the things that I would have you to do. That's what you need to be concerned with. Let me handle your enemies, because I'm the one that can make your enemies your footstool. So don't be angry with your brother without a cause. Check yourself and ask yourself, why am I so angry at them? You know, is it really worth what I'm going through, what I'm dealing with, to be angry? And whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of counsel. Raca let me look at this meaning real quick. It means scoundrel. So you call him a scoundrel. If you call them a scoundrel, why? What made you call your brother a scoundrel? I mean, what purpose did that bring? What does that do for you? How does that make you better? And I think just getting to understand from that perspective, if I call my brother a scoundrel, what does that do for me? How does that benefit me? How does that help me? How does that position me to be a better person, a greater disciple for God? It says you should be in danger of the council. But whosoever say you fool, and when we look at the word fool, we're saying that word is that you're calling them stupid. You're calling them crazy. You're calling them everything that they are not. And so what do you do with that? And how do you make a difference? And again, how does that benefit you? How does that make you better? And I think that's what we have to begin to ask ourselves. If I call you a fool, how does that make me better? What does that do for me? And he says that you would be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, he's saying, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First, be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. So if I'm in the church and I'm saying that I'm giving my gifts to God, and then I remember that somebody's got something against me, then Christ is saying, you need to fix that. Because for you to give your gift to God, and you still got all of these other issues going on with people being mad at you over whatever. Now, I will say this, and I don't want no one to take this wrong, but all you can do is all you can do. If you attempt to go to your brother or sister and make things right, if they're mad at you or they're angry with you and they don't want to hear it, then you've done what you're supposed to do. Then go ahead, go on back to church, give your offering and celebrate God. Because you can't control them. You can't make them not be angry with you or not have an issue with you. It is only for yours to try and reconcile. And once you've done that, then there's no need. There's nothing, because you have no control over how they're going to act and or respond. And so do your part. You go, you try to make amends. If they're not hearing it, if they're not having it, then kind of like what Jesus told the disciples when he sent them out to the city, shake the dust off your feet and move on. You can't get hung up trying to make somebody like you. You can't get hung up trying to make somebody not be angry with you. But it is for you to take the initiative. And I think that's what Jesus is saying right here. Take the initiative to attempt to reconcile. And once you've done that, then you have done what God expects of you to do. Then go on back to the church and present your offering unto God and move on with your life. He is saying, agree with your adversary quickly while you are on the way with him, lest your adversary delivers you to the judge. I don't know why we as Christians seem to always want to run to the secular court about God matters. I think God matters needs us to stay in God's house. But he's saying whatever the issue is, try to reconcile that, because once you get to the court, then you know, it's a good chance that the judge is going to throw the book at you. It's a good chance that the judge is not going to be on your side. There's a good chance that you're going to have to pay the entire penalty of whatever the situation is. So Jesus is saying it's better if you can reconcile with that person, if you can bring about some compromise, than it is for you to stand as a child of God in front of the judge, because the chances are the judge is going to give you the worst penalty that he can give you. And so he moves on to adultery, verse 27. And I guess let me read 27 down to 30. We'll have time to go through that. 27, again, this is the new King James Version of the Bible. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Now, I don't think that Christ is talking about literally here. And I think that we can sometimes get confused with this. I don't believe he's talking about literally when he talks about plucking your eye out and casting and cutting your hand off. He's simply saying control. Control that and understand where it comes from so that you can control it, because it's better for you to control it and make your way to your sense of righteousness than for you to allow that one thing that you have lost control over to cause you to do things that will send you to hell. So let's look at 27. You have heard that it is said. Now again, that is in the Old Testament. That's one of the our Old Testament commandments, thou shalt not commit adultery. You heard that it was said that to those of old, you shall not commit adultery. 28. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her, or a man to lust for him, already have committed adultery with her or him in his or her heart. And so he's saying, let me take it a step deeper, because if the scribes and the Pharisees is saying on the outward, in the physical, if you commit adultery, then you're going to hell. You're going to hell. It's horrible. Jesus is saying it starts in the heart much more than you doing the physical act. You've already done it when you lust. You've already committed adultery in your heart. And so he's again enhancing, showing us a different interpretation of what the law. Keep in mind, the whole segment is about, I did not come to destroy the law, but I come to fulfill it. The law is saying that you should not commit adultery, but I'm saying, but if you've already lusted in your heart, you've already committed adultery, because that's where it starts. It starts there. And then it'll end up places that it should not go. And so again, he's saying, let me help you to fulfill or see the fulfillment of the law through my interpretation of what the law is. What you've gotten from the scribes and Pharisees, it's all outward stuff, when the reality is what you need to understand is all inward stuff. All right. Let me see. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. For it's more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Okay, so again, I don't think that God is talking about plucking out your eye. What I think he's saying is that you have to be careful to control the things that will cause you to do what you know you have no business doing. Where does lust come from? Lust, and he just talked about adultery. So lust first starts when you see and you begin to lust for that in which you see. So if you can't control that, then ultimately you're going to commit, or you've already committed in your heart. Why? Because of what your eye has seen. And so I really believe he's talking about controlling what is causing you to do these things that you know that you should not do. Verse 30, and if the right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Again, you can control where your hands go and what your hands do. And so the inner part of that control is the fact that you got the word of God, and what you believe is that what you need, God will supply for you. If you remember David, who committed adultery with Bathsheba, one of the things that when he was confronted about that adultery, that God said to him that, you know, you had no reason to do that. I've given you everything that you needed. And if you needed more, I would have given it to you. You did not have to take that man's wife. And so I think that what God is trying to get you and I to see is that if we trust him, what he gives us is more than enough to satisfy us. We don't have to go get what God has already given to someone else. He'll give you what you need in order for you to be satisfied and to remain right with him. And so there it is. He gets down to verse 31 where he talks about divorce. He says, furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. Again, he is saying, This is what the Old Testament law is saying, but I'm telling you that it's deeper than that. I'm telling you, look at what you do if you give a woman a letter of divorcement. You don't only separate from her and yourself, but what you're doing is hurting her and hurting the next relationship that she possibly could have. And so he's saying, so be careful when you do these things. Make sure that this is what you are to do. If it's not sexual immorality, then work it out. And if you got God in the midst of it, then God will help you to work it out. And so he moves on through verse number 33. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oath to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all. So the old law was, do not swear falsely. In other words, don't lie. Don't tell a falsehood. And I'm saying, don't tell it at all. Don't swear at all. Neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by earth, for it is the footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the king. Nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. But let your yes be yes, and your no, no. For whatever is more than these is from the evil one. And so you don't have to, I swear to God, I swear on God, I swear on this, I swear on my grace. You don't have to either let your yes be yes. If it's something that it requires your yes, then let it be yes. If it's something that requires a no, then let it be no. But stand on your yes and stand on your no. You don't have to swear about anything. Just yes, I'm going to do it, and no, I'm not going to do it. Yes, I'm going to go, no, I'm not going to go. But you don't have to swear. There's no need to do any of that. That's what Christ is saying. So you need to make sure that you control that. Why are you afraid to let your yes be yes? You're credible. You are a person who has a word. Say your word and keep your word. And I think that Christ is trying to get us to see that our word means something, that our word can be and should be our bond. If you tell a person you're going to do something, then do it. You don't have to swear about it. Just do it. And if you do it, then make sure you do it to the best of your ability. And so, again, we find that Christ is trying to teach the disciples that my fulfillment of the law, not to destroy it, but to enhance, to give you an interpretation that goes a little deeper than what's on the outside. Why? Because I'm the one who's going to be on the inside. I'm the one that's going to stand at the door of your heart and knock. And if you open that door and allow me to come in, I will come in and sup with you and you with me. And so everything starts from the inside. The Spirit of God is in you. That's why everywhere you go, the Spirit is there. Everything you say, the Spirit hears. Everything you see, the Spirit sees. Everything you think, the Spirit knows. Because the Spirit of God is in you as an individual. That's where your power comes from. Your power comes because the Spirit of God is in you. And if the Spirit of God is in you, then the Spirit of God also knows everything that you say, everything that you hear, and everything that you do. And so let your word be your bond. And then honor God. When you tell a brother or sister that you're going to do something, then do just that. Keep your word to the best of your ability. All right, verse number 38 talks about the retaliation. Verse 38 and following. It says, you have heard that it was said. These are the six things I told you in the beginning. He had six things that of the Old Testament Ten Commandments that he addressed, that he takes deeper than what's on the outside. Verse 38, you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you not to resist an evil person, but whosoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. If anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with them too. Give to them who ask you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. Again, this is, it's talking in the sense of don't retaliate. You know, one of the biggest problems, I think, that we have right now, even in our city, is retaliation. I believe that retaliation is what is causing a lot of our people in our community to die from violent acts, from gun violence and other violent acts, is retaliation. And this is how it kind of runs. So someone hurts a member of my family or kills a member of my family, then I won't let that alone. I'm going to retaliate, and I go and kill two members of their family. And then when I do that, then they come back and kill three members of my family, and it goes on and on and on. What Christ is talking about here is, I don't believe it's literally if someone slaps me, I'm going to turn the other cheek. Because I want to be as real as I can. I'm going to defend myself to the best of my ability. But I think what Christ is saying, that if someone does something to me and I go to retaliate against them, I don't think he's talking about someone walking up to me, slapping me, and I defend myself. I think he's talking about someone who does something to me and I do my family member, and then 2 days later, 3 days later, a week later, a month later, I go and retaliate against them because of what they had done to me or done to a family member. And I think, again, the retaliation has gotten us in so much trouble, and it's caused so many people to get harmed, to get hurt, to be murdered. Our homicide is off the chart. And I don't believe all of it is due to gang violence. I don't believe that all of it is due to drug activity. I believe that a whole lot of it, that over 85% of it is retaliation. You done this to my people, I'm gonna do this to your people. You done this to my crew, I'm gonna do this to your crew. And retaliating, and that never stops. If we don't get a handle, that never stops, because there's always somebody to retaliate against unless someone breaks the circle. I do remember one of the mentors I have in our after-school mentoring program at the Baptist Fellowship Center. We were meeting, and he had to lead the meeting, and he said, "Reb, I got to go, because I got to go pick up this guy, and I'm going to knock on his door, and I'm going to tell him to come and go with me to tell another guy that you don't have to retaliate for my son. This person's son was murdered." And so he was going to get the father of this son to tell another person who was ready to retaliate, to please don't do that for my son. And I think we have to get to that point where Christ is talking about here is all about retaliation and how do I retaliate. So I lived through this situation, and now I'm going to turn around and I'm going to go do bodily harm to somebody in your family because of retaliation. I think we have to get beyond that. I think we have to find a way. I think it's too much of that going on. Little children are dying because they're in cars with people that are relatives, and someone is retaliating against them, and the kid also dies in the math in of all of the retaliation that's going on. It's got to stop, y'all. We got to find a way to get past this retaliation situation here in our city. So Luke moves on. I'm down to verse 43. I know I've kind of flown through this, but I hope that you're getting what he's talking about. Let's not retaliate. Let's not take oaths that we can't keep. Our word ought to be good. Let us understand better what divorce means and how it puts the person in a bad spot. Unless it's sexual immorality, work it out. Let us know what adultery does, that it starts in our heart, and then it moves out and manifests itself into a physical action. But if we control it from starting in our heart, then then the chances of it moving to a physical thing is slim to none. Murder. Let's understand that if I can kill somebody with my words, let's understand that it's just not a physical act. But we murder folk all the time with the way we talk about them, the way we misuse them, the way that we actually put them in some category that they shouldn't be in. So let's not do that. Let's not murder people with our words. Let's not murder people in our hearts. Let's not have an adulterous spirit that we're lusting after folk. Let's control that. Let's not just divorce for divorce sake. It used to be a time when we as children of God, we as Christians, the divorce rate was almost non and void. Now you have just as many, if not more, Christians divorcing one another as you do people who never accepted God as their Savior. Why do you have to swear about everything? Let your word be what your word needs to be. If it's yes, it's yes. If it's no, it's no. And let us quit retaliating over stuff that continues to keep us in bondage. It continues to keep us where we're not free for God to use us, where we're not in a position for God to bless us, where we're not capable of allowing God to manifest his gifts in us so that we can be a blessing to someone else. And then, of course, he talks about here at the, actually coming up on the end of the chapter, of chapter 5, he talks about love. He says, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I want you to go a little deeper. Let me take you a little deeper, Jesus is saying. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun, S-U-N, rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Okay, we're going to pick up the love piece because I just don't want to run through that quickly. On next week, we'll pick up the love piece here at the end of chapter 5 before we move into chapter 6, talking about charitable deeds. Because the love is so strong that I think it's due us to do due diligence and talk about love, because without love, we have nothing. God is love, and we ought to thank God that he is love, because it's his love that caused his son to die on the cross for our sins, because he loved us just that much. It is his love that is so unconditional that regardless of how far we fall, we never fall far enough that his love, his grace, won't reach down and pick us up. So I think we need to spend some time talking about love, because one of the things that is hurting us even in our day and time is the lack of love one for another, the lack of agape love, the lack of the godly love. And so I want to spend time for us on next week talking about love. And so please understand that the whole message that Jesus was trying to get to his disciples is, I did not come to destroy the law, but I came to enhance. I came to fulfill it. I come to take you deeper in it. I come to show you a way, because of the fact that out on the inside, you need to understand that everything starts from your heart. Everything resonates from that. And so every now and then, you and I ought to have a heart check. And I'm not talking about our cardiologist. I'm talking about Jesus, our Christ. And I think that maybe that's a question for us to ponder for this week. And that is, where am I in comparison to my heart and where my heart should be? Am I and my heart lining up to be and to do the things that God has made before me to do? I think that's a good question for us to ponder this week, is to look at our own hearts. Now, many of you who know me know that I'm not the guy, not that I have anything against it, that says, look at your neighbor and give him a high five and all of that. That's fine. I have nothing against that. I don't know about thinking that I do. But I conclude that I can give my neighbor a high five, but I can't control my neighbor. There's nothing that I can do that would make my neighbor do anything, but I can control what I do. I can make a difference in my life. I can change me. And so I think most of the time with me, I want you to look at yourself and see, how can I change? How can I be better? So this week, I want you to ponder the question, is my heart and my actions lining up? Is my heart and who I know myself to be, is that lining up? Is the heart that is operating me now the heart that I want to operate me? If not, then you can change it. You can change how you view things. You can change how you look at things. You can change how you view people and look at people. You're the one that can make the change, because it's in your heart. And so, as we prepare to close out tonight, thank you again for all that is with us, all that has joined us. Thank you so very, very much. Thank you for all of the committee who's working on the pastor's 19th pastoral anniversary here at the Baptist Fellowship Center. I'm sorry, Baptist, at Beargrass Missionary Baptist Church. 19-year celebration of the pastor and first lady. People and pastor, pulpit and pew, we will celebrate this coming Sunday. We're delighted to have Pastor Linnea McDaniel from the Tabernacle Baptist Church here in our city to join us. We will start Sunday morning at 11 a.m. We are looking for a high time in the Lord. Again, we don't own any of the music that you're hearing in the background. Just get ready for a blessing. And we appreciate, again, those who are blessing us through the music ministry. So you have a wonderful rest of your week. What would make me happier than anything else is for you to show up. Your presence means a lot on Sunday morning. And join us in this celebration that God is allowing us to have when he put pastor and people together. And I believe that if we would just celebrate God in such a way, that God will bless our efforts and that we will see changes coming in the lives of many people in the days, weeks, months, and years to come. All right, we're coming to the end. We got one more minute. We're coming to the end of our lesson tonight. Again, thank you so much for those who have joined us. I hope you understand that Jesus wants to take you deeper. Jesus wants you to be a disciple. Jesus was helping his disciple to see beyond what the scribes and Pharisees who represented the church, what they were doing. And he said very plainly that your righteousness, your understanding, it has to be greater than what they're doing if you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. All right, you have a good night, and we will look to see you on Sunday morning here at the Beargrass Missionary Baptist Church, 2300 Payne Street, Louisville, Kentucky, at the 19th year anniversary of Pastor and First Lady Smyzer and the Beargrass family. Again, thank you, and have a wonderful night. Good night. God does have a blessing with your name on it. Good night to each and every one of you.